Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ. Welcome to this live-streamed broadcast of the closing ceremony of the 7th Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions in Nur-Sultan, Kazakhstan, this Thursday, September 15th. My name is Francesca Merlo and I'll be providing the English commentary for this morning's event. Whether you're joining us through various Vatican media channels, the Vatican audio or radio app, the Vatican News web portal or YouTube channel, or via one of our partner stations including Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World Television Networks USA, EWTN TV, Salt and Light TV, Luminous Radio India, Catholic TV, Shalom TV India, and Sunday Shalom, a warm welcome to you all. The local time in Kazakhstan is 3 p.m., 2:59, and as we wait for the meeting to begin, just a little bit about this 7th Congress. Now, this two-day meeting, which takes place every 3 years, has brought together religious leaders from around the world to focus this time on how religious leaders can foster the spiritual and social development in the post-pandemic world. Over 100 delegations from 50 countries are attending the Congress, made up of religious, cultural, civil, governmental and non-governmental representatives. Pope Francis traveled to Kazakhstan to participate personally in this meeting, following the invitation of the nation's president, Kasym-Jomart Tokayev. Now, the Congress was established at the initiative of Kazakhstan's first president, Nur-Sultan Nazarbayev, in direct response to the rise in religious tensions and extremism following the 9/11 terrorist attack in the United States. The Holy Father has just entered the Congress Center. You can see the religious leaders at a round table standing up. Here we see the religious leaders. We are expecting to hear from some of these leaders throughout the course of this closing ceremony, as well as from Pope Francis, who is now taking his seat. This is the final event of Pope Francis's apostolic journey to Kazakhstan.
Rim Papası Francisk, Jogarı Mertebeliler, Kurmetti Forumga Katuşlar Men Mimandar. Biz bugün Elemdik Jani Dasturlı Dindir Liderlerinin 7-ші съезін Kortınlau Üşün Jinalı Otırmız. Кешегі пленарлық отырысымыз өте мазмұнды өтті. Түске дейінде секциялық отырыстар аясында нәтижелі пікір алмасулар болды. Жалпы осы екі күннің ішінде съезге қатысушылар арасында ашық және салиқалы диалог болды деп айталамыз. Форумға қатысушылар мен қонақтар адамзаттың пандемиядан кейінгі кезеңдегі рухани әлеуметтік дамуының күн тәртібін жан-жақты талқылады. Сондай-ақ геосаяси сын-қатерлерді еңсеру, қақтығыстарды тоқтату, бейбітшілікке қол жеткізіп оны нығайту жолындағы діндердің рөлі мен әлеуеті айқындалды. Дин лидерлері съезд мінберінен бейбітшілік пен диалогты қолдауға арналған маңызды ойлар айтты. Мұндай идеялар мен ұсыныстар үйлесімді әрі өркендеген әлем құруға өз үлесін қосады деп сенеміз. Уважаемые участники и гости съезда, важные идеи и предложения 7-го съезда в концептуальном виде представлены в его итоговой декларации. Особое внимание в этом документе уделено необходимости объединения усилий всего человечества в преодолении последствий пандемии. В декларации обозначены актуальные задачи, стоящие перед мировым сообществом по продвижению культуры диалога и взаимопонимания, прекращению конфликтов и противостояния. Проект этого документа был предметно рассмотрен и обсужден рабочей группой и секретариатом съезда. Поступившие предложения были в основном учтены. Всем участникам съезда документ был роздан. Надеемся, что важные посылы декларации будут способствовать укреплению межцивилизационного и межрелигиозного диалога и формированию общих подходов по актуальным вопросам современного мира. На заседании секретариата съезда также были рассмотрены сроки проведения следующего.
We are hearing the discourse of Molin Ashimbayev, who is the head of the Secretariat of the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions and Chairman of the Senate of the Parliament of the Republic of Kazakhstan.
Если у участников съезда нет возражений, то позвольте объявить декларацию 7-го съезда лидеров мировых и традиционных религий принятой. Уважаемые участники и гости форума.
He has declared the declaration as having been approved, the final declaration.
Слово для оглашения текста декларации предоставляется специальному представителю Англиканской церкви на съезде.
And now he is introducing the reading of the declaration of the document.
We, the participants of the 7th Congress, spiritual leaders of world and traditional religions, politicians, heads of international organizations, guided by our shared desire for a just, peaceful, secure, and prosperous world, affirming the importance of shared values in the spiritual and social development of humankind, recognizing the necessity of countering and overcoming intolerance, xenophobia, discrimination, and conflicts based on ethnic, religious, and cultural differences, respecting the richness of religious and cultural diversity, realizing that acts of charity, compassion, mercy, justice, and solidarity contribute to the rapprochement of peoples and societies, recognizing the value of education and spirituality for personal and interreligious development, affirming the importance of the role and rights of women in society, stating that material inequality leads to discontent, social tension, conflict and crisis in our world, recognizing the importance of addressing global challenges in our post-pandemic world, including climate change, poverty and hunger, organized crime, terrorism and drugs, condemning in the strongest terms the extremism, radicalism and terrorism which lead to religious persecution and the undermining of human life and dignity, condemning the creation of hotspots of interstate and international tension in the world, expressing serious concern about the global increase in the number of migrants and refugees in need of humanitarian assistance and protection, expressing a firm desire to contribute to the creations of conditions for reconciliation and dialogue between conflicting parties, realizing the urgent necessity for spiritual and political leaders to work together in addressing the challenges of our world, welcoming all international, regional, national, and local initiatives, especially the efforts of religious leaders to promote interreligious, intercultural, and intercivilizational dialogue, expressing the intention to intensify cooperation between religious communities, international, national, and public institutions, and non-governmental organizations in the post-pandemic period, reaffirming the work of the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions as an international, interreligious dialogue platform for representatives of many religions, confessions, and creeds, and pointing out the opportunity of the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions for taking further specific steps to expand interfaith, interreligious, and intercivilizational dialogue. We, the leaders of this Congress, have come to a common position and declare the following. Number one, we will make every effort to ensure that the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions continues its regular activities for the benefit of peace and dialogue between religions, cultures, and civilizations. Number two, we declare that in the conditions of the post-pandemic development of the world and the globalization of world processes and security threats, the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions plays an important role in the implementation of joint efforts to strengthen dialogue in the name of peace and cooperation, as well as the promotion of spiritual and moral values. Number three, we recognize that the negative consequences of pandemic disease can be overcome only through joint effort, working together and helping each other. Number four, we are convinced that the unleashing of any military conflict, creating hot spots of tension and confrontation, causes chain reactions which impair international relations. Number five, we believe that extremism, radicalism, terrorism, and all other forms of violence and wars, whatever their goals, have nothing to do with true religion and must be rejected in the strongest possible terms. Number six, we strongly urge national governments and authorized international organizations to provide comprehensive assistance to all religious groups and ethnic communities that have been subjected to infringements of rights and violence by extremists and terrorists as a result of wars and military conflicts. Number seven, we call upon world leaders to abandon all aggressive and destructive rhetoric which leads to destabilization of the world and to cease from conflict and bloodshed in all corners of our world. Number eight, we call upon religious leaders and prominent political figures from different parts of the world tirelessly to develop dialogue in the name of friendship, solidarity, and peaceful coexistence. Number nine, we advocate the active involvement of the leaders of world and traditional religions and prominent political figures in the process of conflict resolution for achieving long-term stability. Number 10, we note that pluralism and differences in religion, skin color, gender, race, and language are expressions of the wisdom of God's will in creation. Thus, any incidence of coercion to a particular religion and religious doctrine is unacceptable. Number 11, we call for the support of all practical initiatives to implement interreligious and interdenominational dialogue for the sake of building social justice and solidarity for all peoples. 12, we stand in solidarity with the efforts of the United Nations and all other international, governmental, and regional institutions and organizations to promote dialogue among civilizations and religions, states, and nations. Number 13, we recognize the importance and value of the document on human fraternity for world peace and living together between the Holy See and Al-Azhar al-Sharif, adopted by the UN General Assembly in Resolution A, Res 75-200 of December 21st, 2020, and the Makkah Declaration, adopted in Mecca in May 2019, which calls for peace, dialogue, mutual understanding, and mutual respect among believers for the common good. 14. We welcome the progress made by the global community in the fields of science, technology, medicine, industry, and other areas, yet note the importance of their harmonization with spiritual, social, and human values. 15. We realize that social problems often push people to extreme action and call on all states of the world to ensure adequate living conditions for their citizens. 16. We note how people and societies which dismiss the importance of spiritual values and moral guidelines are susceptible to lose their humanity and creativity. 17. We call on world political and business leaders to focus on overcoming the imbalances in the development of modern societies and to reduce the gap in the well-being of different segments of the population and different countries of the world. 18. We note the positive impact of dialogue between leaders of world and traditional religions for socio-political processes in states and societies, contributing to the preservation of peace. 19. We proceed from the immutable fact that the Almighty created all people equal, regardless of their racial, religious, ethnic, or other affiliation or social status. Therefore, tolerance, respect, and mutual understanding underpin all religious teaching. 20. We call on political and public figures, journalists and bloggers, to beware religious generalization and not to identify extremism and terrorism with whole nations and peace-loving religions. 21. We advocate increasing the role of education and religious formation in strengthening the respectful coexistence of religions and cultures and debunking dangerous pseudo-religious prejudices. 22. We pay special attention to the importance of strengthening the institution of the family. 23. We stand for the protection of the dignity and rights of women, the improvement of their social status as equal members of family and society. 24. We note the inevitability of global digital development, as well as the importance of the role of religious and spiritual leaders in interacting with politicians in solving the problems of digital inequality. 25. We strive to develop a dialogue with the media and other institutions of society to clarify the significance of religious values for promoting religious literacy, interreligious tolerance, and civil peace. 26. We appeal to all people of faith and goodwill to unite in this difficult time and contribute to ensuring harmony and security in our common home, planet Earth. 27. We appeal to all people of faith and, 27. We turn to pray in support of all people of goodwill on the planet who make a significant contribution to the expansion of intercivilizational, interreligious, and international dialogue for the sake of a more prosperous world. 28. We call for supporting acts of mercy and compassion in regions affected by military conflict as a result of both natural and man-made disasters. 29. We call for solidarity in the support of international organizations and national governments in their efforts to overcome the consequences of the COVID pandemic. 30. We affirm that the purposes of the Congress and this declaration are to guide contemporary and future generations of humankind in promoting a culture of tolerance, mutual respect, and peacefulness, available for use in public administration of any country in the world, as well as by international organizations, including UN institutions. 31. We instruct the Secretariat of the Congress to develop a concept for the development of the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions as a global interreligious dialogue platform for 2023 to 2033. 32, we affirm the role of the public of Kazakhstan as an authoritative and global center of inter-civilizational, inter-religious, and interfaith dialogue. 33, we thank the Republic of Kazakhstan and President Kasym Jomart Tokayev for their human initiatives for convening the 7th Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions, and for their contribution to creation and progress, peace and harmony. 34, we thank the Republic of Kazakhstan for the excellent organization of the Congress, and to the Kazakh people for their cordiality and hospitality. And 35, we confirm our collective interest in continuing the activities of the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions, and our intention to convene the next 8th Congress in 2025 in the capital of the Republic of Kazakhstan, Nur-Sultan. This declaration was adopted by the majority of the delegates of the 7th Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions and is being transmitted to the authorities, political leaders, and religious figures around the world, relevant regional and international organizations, civil society organizations, religious associations, and leading experts. It will also be distributed as an official document of the 77th session of the UN General Assembly. The principles contained in the current declaration can be disseminated at all regional and international levels for consideration in all political decisions, legislative norms, educational programs, and mass media in all interested countries. May our aspirations be blessed, and may peace and prosperity be granted to all peoples and countries. From the Republic of Kazakhstan, Nur-Sultan, September 15th, 2022.
That was Bishop Joe Bailey Wells reading the final declaration of the Congress. And now Maulin Ashimbayev again.
Для меня большая честь предоставить слово почетному гостю и участнику съезда, главе католической церкви, его святейшеству.
For me, it is a great honor to now give the word to the head of the Catholic Church and our guest, Pope Francis, and we will now hear Pope Francis's discourse. As I mentioned earlier, this is the final event of Pope Francis's 38th apostolic journey to abroad in Kazakhstan. Dear brothers and sisters, we have traveled this road together, and I thank you for coming from so many different parts of the world and for bringing with you the richness of your beliefs and cultures. Thank you for having taken part so intensely in these days of work, commitment and sharing in the service of dialogue. This is more valuable than ever in challenging times like our own, when the problems of the pandemic have been compounded by the utter folly of war. There are altogether too many cases of hatred and division, too little dialogue and effort to understand others. In our globalized world, this is all the more dangerous and scandalous. Our human family cannot advance if simultaneously united and divided, interconnected and torn apart by massive inequality. Thank you then for these efforts to build peace and unity. Our thanks go likewise to the local authorities who hosted us and organized this Congress with great care, and to the hospitable and courageous people of Kazakhstan, capable of embracing other cultures while at the same time preserving their own noble history and precious traditions. Kiob Rakhmet, Bolshoe Spasibo, thank you very much.
Ha come motto messaggeri di pace e di unità e al plurale perché il cammino è comune.
The motto of my visit, now drawing to an end, has been messengers of peace and unity. It is deliberately in the plural, for all of us are on a common journey. This seventh Congress, in which we have taken part by the grace of the Almighty, has marked an important step on the shared itinerary. Since its inception in 2003, this event has taken as its model the Day of Prayer for Peace in the World, convened in 2002 in Assisi by John Paul II, in order to reaffirm the positive contribution made by the religious traditions to dialogue and to harmony between peoples. After the events of the 11th of September 2001, it was necessary to respond collectively to the incendiary atmosphere that terrorist violence sought to incite, and which threatened to turn religion into a grounds for conflict. Pseudo-religions, terrorism, extremism, radicalism and nationalism, dressed up in religious garb, nonetheless continued to foment fears and concerns about religion. In these days, then, it proved providential that we could come together once more in order to reaffirm the authentic and inalienable essence of religion. In this regard, the declaration of the Seventh Congress states that extremism, radicalism, terrorism, and all other incentives to hatred, hostility, violence, and war, whatever their motivations or goals, have nothing to do with the authentic spirit of religion and must be rejected in the most decisive terms possible, without ifs or buts. Furthermore, since the Almighty has created all people equal, regardless of their religious, ethnic, or social origin, we are agreed that mutual respect and understanding should be considered essential and indispensable in religious teaching. Kazakhstan, at the heart of the great and pivotal continent of Asia, was the natural place for us to meet. Its flag reminded us of the need to maintain a healthy relationship between politics and religion. Indeed, if the golden eagle displayed on that flag speaks of earthly authority and ancient empires, the blue background evokes the color of the sky and thus transcendence. There is thus a healthy connection between politics and transcendence, a sound form of coexistence that keeps their spheres distinct, distinct but not confused or separate. Let us say no to their confusion, for the sake of all people who need, like the eagle, a free sky in which to fly, a free space open to the infinite and not straitened by earthly power. Transcendence, for its part, must not yield to the temptation to turn into power, lest heaven fall to earth, the eternal beyond be chained to an earthly present, and love of neighbor become prey to partisan decisions. No, then, to confusion between politics and transcendence, but no also to their separation. For the highest human aspirations cannot be excluded from public life and relegated solely to the private sphere. Consequently, those who legitimately desire to voice their beliefs must be protected, always and everywhere. Yet how many people are even now persecuted and discriminated against on account of their faith? We have insistently appealed to governments and relevant international organizations to provide assistance to religious groups and ethnic communities whose human rights and fundamental freedoms have been violated or subjected to violence by extremists and terrorists, also as a result of wars and military conflicts. Above all, we must ensure that religious freedom will never be a mere abstraction but a concrete right. We defend everyone's right to religion, to hope, to beauty, to heaven. Kazakhstan is, in the words of its national anthem, a sky of golden sun, and the same is true of each human being. In their absolute uniqueness, if they are in contact with the divine, every man and woman can radiate a special light in our world. For this reason, the Catholic Church, which tirelessly proclaims the inviolable dignity of each person created in the image of God, also believes in the unity of the human family. The Church believes that all humanity forms but one community. This is so because all stem from the one stock that God created to people the entire earth, and because all share a common destiny, namely God. His providence, evident goodness, and saving designs extend to all mankind. Hence, from the outset of this Congress, the Holy See, particularly through its Dicastery for Interreligious Dialogue, has taken an active part in it. It wishes to continue to do so, for the path of interreligious dialogue is a shared path to peace and for peace. As such, it is necessary and irrevocable. Interreligious dialogue is no longer merely something expedient. It is an urgent, needed, and incomparable service to humanity, to the praise and glory of the Creator of all. Brothers and sisters, in thinking of this shared path, I ask myself, what is our point of convergence? Pope John Paul II, who visited Kazakhstan 21 years ago this very month, stated that for the Church all ways lead to man, and that man is the way for the Church. I would like to say that today man is also the way for all the religions. Yes, man, men and women, concrete human beings weakened by the pandemic, worn out by war, wounded by indifference. Human beings, frail and marvelous creatures, who once God is forgotten are left in darkness and apart from others cannot survive. The good of humanity should be taken into consideration ahead of strategic and economic objectives, national, energy and military interests, and in advance of crucial decisions. To make decisions that are truly great, we should look to children, to young people and their future, to the elderly and their wisdom, to ordinary people and their genuine needs. We have spoken out and insisted that the human person cannot be reduced to what he or she produces and earns, that human beings must be accepted and never discarded, that the family, a word that in the Kazakh language means nest of soul and love, is a natural and irreplaceable reality that must be protected and promoted so that tomorrow's men and women may grow and mature. For all human beings, the great religious and wisdom traditions are calls to testify to the existence of a shared spiritual and moral patrimony based on two principles, transcendence and fraternity. Transcendence, the beyond, worship. It is impressive that each day millions and millions of men and women of different ages, cultures and social conditions join together in prayer in countless places of worship. This is the hidden force that makes our world move forward. And then, fraternity, the other, proximity. For one cannot profess genuine fidelity to the Creator without showing love for His creatures. This is the spirit that pervades the declaration of our Congress. In concluding, I would like to emphasize three words that it contains. The first word is a synthesis of everything, the expression of a heartfelt plea, the dream and the goal of our journey. peace, Bebicilik, Mir Pacem. Peace is urgently needed because in our day every military conflict or hotspot of tension and confrontation will necessarily have a baneful domino effect and seriously compromise the system of international relations. Peace, on the other hand, is more than the absence of war. It cannot be reduced to the maintenance of the balance of power between opposing forces, nor does it arise out of despotic dominion, but it is appropriately called the effect of righteousness. Peace is born of fraternity. It grows through the struggle against injustice and inequality. It is built by holding out a hand to others. We who believe in the Creator of all must be on the front lines in promoting the growth of peaceful coexistence. We must bear witness to peace, preach peace, implore peace. The declaration thus exhorts world leaders to put an end to conflicts and bloodshed everywhere and to abandon aggressive and destructive rhetoric. We plead with you, in the name of God and for the good of humanity, work for peace, not weapons. Only by serving the cause of peace will you make a name for yourselves in the annals of history. If peace is lacking, it is because care, tender love, the ability to generate life are lacking. Our quest of peace must thus increasingly involve, and here is the second word, women. Because women bestow care and life upon the world. They are themselves a path towards peace. For this reason, we have endorsed the need to defend their dignity and to improve their social status as equal members of the family and of society. Women must also be entrusted with greater positions and responsibilities. How many calamitous decisions might have been avoided had women been directly involved in decision-making? We commit ourselves to ensuring that women are increasingly respected, acknowledged, and involved. Lastly, the third word, the young. Young people are messengers of peace and unity, in the present and in the future. It is they who more than anyone else call for peace and respect for the common home of creation. The ingrained attitudes of domination and exploitation, the hoarding of resources, nationalism, war, and carving out spheres of influence shape an older world, which the young reject, a world that has no room for their hopes and dreams. In the same way, harsh and repressive forms of religion belong not to the future, but to the past. Mindful of future generations, we have stressed the importance of education, which strengthens mutual acceptance and respectful coexistence among different religions and cultures. Let us put into the hands of the young opportunities for education, not weapons of destruction. And let us listen to them, without being afraid to be challenged by their questions. Above all, let us build a world with them in mind. Brothers and sisters, the people of Kazakhstan, open to tomorrow, yet mindful of yesterday's suffering, point us by their extraordinary wealth of religions and cultures towards the future. They encourage us to create that future without forgetting transcendence and fraternity, worship of the Most High, and acceptance of our brothers and sisters. Let us press ahead on this path, walking together on earth as children of heaven, weavers of hope, and artisans of concord, heralds of peace and unity.
Благодарим вас, ваше святейшество, за ваши теплые слова в адрес съезда и нашей страны. Ваша поддержка чрезвычайно важна для продвижения идей. Желаем вам долгих лет жизни и дальнейшего плодотворного духовного служения во благо
человечества.
Уважаемые участники съезда,
wishing him long life and ministry for the good of the people. And the word now goes to the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, Sheikh Professor Ahmed El-Tayeb.
As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. أبدأ كلمتي الختامية بتقديم الشكر مرة أخرى إلى السيد الرئيس قاسم جومارت توقايف رئيس جمهورية قزاخستان وللشعب القزاخي الكريم ولكل من وقف خلف هذا المؤتمر المتميز الناجح وأسهم في إخراجه على هذا النحو الرائع ولا أجد في جعبتي
The Grand Imam is thanking the President and the people of Kazakhstan and the organizers of this event.
من قرارات وتوصيات هذا المؤتمر والتي تبناها المؤتمرون في التوصيات الأخيرة وسمعناها منذ لحظات وإني لأراها توصيات تمس الكثير من المشكلات التي يئن منها المجتمع الدولي بأغنيائه وفقرائه على السواء نتيجة صمت العالم المتحضر ولا مبالاته بما يلحق الفقراء والبائسين ومن لا حول لهم ولا قوة
The Grand Imam is saying that the declaration touched all of the issues and that everything that is of great importance has already been said and written in this declaration. Especially in a world in which there is so much poverty.
لكن حين يأخذه فإنه لا يفلته أبدا وما يمكن أن أكرره في ختام هذا المؤتمر هو أن رسالة الأديان لن تبلغ هدفها ما لم تتحد وما لم يتحد أهلها وما لم يكونوا قوة تعمل أولاً على تنقية الشعور الديني من الضغائن والأحقاد وإنما يتوصل إلى ذلك بأمور أولاً توجيه النشاط الديني في الأديان المختلفة إلى هذا الاتجاه الإنساني
What the Grand Imam is saying is that What he would like to repeat is that the message of the religions, the declaration, will not be able to reach its objectives until the religions are not united. We must readdress the activities of the religions towards unity.
وإذاعة ذلك بمختلف الوسائل في مختلف اللغات ثالثاً الاعتماد في نشر هذه المعاني العامة على أساس عقلي محض وحب للحقيقة
This can be done by gathering the different values, the highest values of every religion and sharing them everywhere, always with a basis of truth in the diffusion of these values. Making sure to always stay away from anything that could hurt our brothers and sisters. And this is also the message of Islam.
هذا وإن لي في تجربتي وثيقة الأخوة الإنسانية ما يشجعنا اليوم على هذه المبادرة. فبرغم اختلافنا أنا وأخي بابا فرانسيس.
It is the message of Islam and it is the message of all religions.
ولغة ولونا وتاريخا ووطنا. بالرغم من ذلك كله وبالرغم من أن آراء متشددة على الطرفين حاولت أن تعرقل بل ما زالت تحاول العرقلة بل إن بعضها حرم مجرد التقاء شيخ الأزهر وبابا الكنيسة الكاثوليكية برغم ذلك كله إلا أننا حين اجتمعنا ومنذ اللقاء الأول بنية صادقة شعر كل منا بأنه يعرف صاحبه منذ سنين عدة ثم ما لبثت القلوب أن التقت على المودة المتبادلة وعلى الصداقة والإخلاص وكان توفيق الله تعالى كبيرا في إتمام وثيقة الأخوة الإنسانية تلكم الوثيقة التي جاءت كأول ميثاق إنساني بين المسيحيين
Speaking from his own experience, especially on the document on human fraternity signed by the Grand Imam and Pope Francis, he says that despite the differences and the forces that perhaps tried to stop them, they were able to go forward because their hearts met in friendship and in respect. And this is what brought to the birth and to the signing, consequent signing of this document.
وفي اعتقادي أن شفاء البشرية من أمراضها الحديثة وفي مقدمتها مرض العمى عن الحقيقة لم يعد رهن أي تقدم مادي أو رقي تكنولوجي بل هو فيما أتيقن رهن تقدم روحي أخلاقي تمثل فيه الأديان حجر الزاوية بل قطب الرحى شكرا لحسن استماعكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله
The healing of humanity does not depend on technological progress but on a spiritual process and that is the end of the Grand Imam's discourse
Мы признательны вам за большой вклад в дело продвижения идеи мира и межрелигиозного диалога. Спасибо. Ваше превосходительство, следующее слово предоставляется...
And now Maulin Ashimbayev is thanking the Grand Imam and is handing, passing the word over to Metropolitan Anthony Volokolamsky, who is the chairman of the Department for External Church Relations and Moscow Patriarchate.
Начиная с 2003 года заседания съезда проходит на
The Congress is for the whole world. It is a platform of interreligious dialogue. Since 2003, these congresses happen regularly and gather religious leaders from the whole world. Thank you to the organizers and to the President of the Republic of Kazakhstan. The main theme of this meeting has been strengthening peace between religions and peoples. This theme is always more important nowadays.
Участвовать во врачевании конфликтов, утешать страждущих. С удовлетворением хотел бы отметить, что в итоговом документе съезда содержится ряд очень значимых положений.
The importance is to reduce suffering and conflict. We are sure that in the final declaration
Очень важной является мысль о необходимости сохранения
There are the words and the moral orientation to overcome some of these tensions while still always maintaining our cultural, moral, religious diversities, which help to unite the various religions despite their differences. This is why we give our support for interreligious dialogue. And this is why religious education is an excellent tool to help prevent terrorism and extremism. The inequalities and poor distribution between countries, especially in health and food, gives us even more reason to cooperate throughout institutions, religions, and states in the world. Because it is important today to put an end to these injustices. The Declaration of our Congress is based on creation, on the existence of God, and on the words of God, especially on the moral principles. It is also important to strengthen the authority of religious leaders and transmit this to the whole of society so that people will listen to their words. Often people forget simple issues facing society and humanity. For example, always being loyal to one's own soul. And we hope that the different religious leaders can help people to re-listen to themselves and to the importance of this. I thank all of the participants for their openness to dialogue and for this communication that was extremely powerful and fruitful over those few days. Thank you for your ministry. Thank you. And now back to Maulin Ashimbayev. Thanking Metropolitan Anthony Bolokolamsky for his words. And now the word goes to the Minister for Islamic Issues, Abdulaziz Asheko.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين أما بعد صاحب الفخامة رئيس جمهورية كازاخستان الشقيقة قاسم جومارت توكايف قداسة البابا الفاتيكان فضيلة الإمام الأكبر شيخ الأزهر الشريف أيها الحضور أصحاب المعالي والسماحة والسعادة السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته أحييكم جميعا وأنقل لكم تحيات مولاي خادم الحرمين الشريفين
He is thanking the President, the Pope, the Grand Imam and all those taking part in the Congress.
محمد بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز آل سعود حفظهم الله وهو أن يكون فخامة الرئيس
on behalf of the king of the kingdom of Saudi Arabia
بدور فاعل في بناء الحوار بين الحضارات مثمنا جهود فخامتكم حفظكم الله في دعم هذه الأعمال التي تعزز بناء الأوطان وخدمة الإنسان. وقد ظهر لنا من خلال هذا المؤتمر الدور الكبير والمسؤولية العظيمة.
He is expressing his congratulations with the President for the fruitful outcome of this meeting.
في ممارسة القيم الإنسانية المشتركة كالرحمة والعدل والبر والإحسان والتعايش.
A meeting that promotes the value of every human person as well as the value of dialogue and the value of peace.
والاعتدال ونبذ الغلو والتطرف وكل ما يكون سببا في النزاع والشر بين الناس. ولقد استعرضت في كلمتي في افتتاح هذا المؤتمر دور المملكة العربية السعودية الريادي في خدمة الإنسانية وتعزيز مبادئ قيم العدل والتسامح كونها قبلة المسلمين ومهبط الوحي والرسالة.
And represents a point with which to strengthen the common values and to begin again with the basis of these.
وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. كما استعرضت التجربة الناجحة للمؤسسات الدينية في المملكة العربية السعودية مع أزمة كورونا وما ساهمت به في تحجيم انتشار هذا الفيروس حيث كانت المملكة العربية السعودية بفضل الله أنموذجاً رائعاً في مواجهة هذه الجائحة. فخامة الرئيس، الحضور الكرام، إن المملكة العربية السعودية بقيادة
He is now speaking of the role of Saudi Arabia in sharing the values of Islam and the way in which the kingdom dealt with the COVID-19 pandemic.
في مكافحة الإرهاب والتطرف وتسهم بدور فاعل في تعزيز التواصل بين الحضارات من خلال رسالتها السامية القائمة على السلام والعدل والتسامح والاعتدال. مؤكدين على أهمية تعزيز قيم التعايش بين الأديان والحضارات والشعوب بمكوناتها المختلفة. وفي ختام كلمتي هذه أكرر شكري وتقديري لفخامة الرئيس على ما لقيناه من كرم الضيافة وحسن الاستقبال متمنيا لكم وللشعب الكازاخي
The Kingdom of Saudi Arabia will do everything to contrast violence and terrorism and supports dialogue for the good that it brings. And that is the end of his discourse, which he concludes by thanking the President.
Главному ашкеназскому раввину Израиля Дэвиду Лау. Уважаемый Ребе, вам слово.
Now, the word goes to Chief Rabbi David Lau.
מכבדים את העולם כאשר אתם באים להדגיש זאת. תודה לכם מאוד על הארגון, על הפעילות, ושוב, גם על ההתמדה. אנחנו כבר רושמים בפנינו את הכנס השמיני. מכובדיי, בסידור התפילות של העם היהודי ישנה תפילה בקשה שאיתה פותחים בבוקר את התפילה. אנחנו מבקשים שם בקשה מיוחדת מאוד. אנחנו מבקשים, אלוקים, עזור לנו שנראה כל אחד מעלות חברינו.
Mankind can become the road.
אנחנו יודעים שגם ישנם חסרונות אצל השני.
And there is a question born in my heart. Show us the Father, because I want to live well, I want to live happy, I want a long life. And I begin to realize that this life is the relationship with He who gave us life.
וכפי שהזכיר כבוד האפיפיור, מכובדי, הזכיר את הביטוי של סמל קזחסטן, שהוא כמו נשק.
The great missionary journey that we have had the joy of meeting this face of mystery, which is in every person reflecting the image.
וזו ההדגשה החשובה כל כך של הכנס הזה. אבל אני מבקש לא להסתפק במילים, אלא אני מבקש לפנות אליכם, מנהיגי הדתות מכל רחבי העולם, בכנס החשוב הזה, במושב הנעילה של הכנס. אחריו, חוזר כל אחד לביתו, לקהילתו ולקהל מאמיניו. אני מבקש מכם, השמיעו את קולכם. השמיעו את קולכם בכל פעם שיש ולו רמז קל לאנטישמיות במדינות שלכם. יש כלל ביהדות שעבירה גוררת עבירה. כל אירוע שעובר בשתיקה מוליד אחריו אירוע נוסף. ואנחנו יודעים, ואני מבקש ביחד איתכם, אסור שיהודי יפחד ללכת בעולם חופשי עם סממן דתי, כיפה, על ראשו בכל רחבי העולם. תפקיד המנהיגים הדתיים הוא להתריע בשער על תופעות מסוכנות, על הקצנה אנטישמית שמתפתחת במדינות רבות ברחבי העולם. תגנו, תכתבו, תעירו הערה, תהיו פעילים במאבק אנטישמי, זה מה שיסייע במניעתו ברחבי העולם. ודבר נוסף אני מבקש להדגיש. יש כלל ביהדות האומר שתיקה כהודאה. שתיקה כהודאה זה אומר שמנהיג דתי ששותק מול גילוי אנטישמיות זה עלול להיות משתי סיבות. זה יכול להיות או שחלילה הוא מסכים לה, או שאולי הוא חושב שהיא לא מסוכנת. היא מסוכנת. כל תופעה, כל מקרה, ולו הקטן ביותר. תפקידנו כמנהיגי דתות הוא לא לשתוק, לעצור את שרשרת העבירות האנושיות הללו. בני אלוקים אחד אנחנו, בני אנוש כולנו, וכעם אחד, כעולם אחד, כאכפתיים עבור העולם, שווים אנחנו ומודים לנשיא הרפובליקה של קזחסטן, שחיבר אותנו, ועם המסר הזה נשוב לארצותינו, לבתינו, לקהילותינו, ונחזור ונאמר שוב, אנחנו מבקשים להדגיש את ההדגשה החשובה כל כך, המהותית כל כך, התפילה הגדולה שאנחנו מתפללים כולנו, להשם יברך את העולם כולו בשלום, שלום ובריאות ושמחה על כל יושבי תבל.
Благодарим вас, уважаемый ребе, за содержательное выступление и вклад в развитие
международного диалога.
Құрметті форумға қатысушылар мен меймандар, әлемдік және дәстүрлі діндер лидерлерінің 7-ші съезін қорытындылау үшін сөз Қазақстан Республикасының президенті жоғары мәртебелі Қасым-Жомарт Кемелұлы Тоқаевқа беріледі.
Аса қадірлі меймандар, құрметті съезге қатысушылар, қазақ жері екі күннен бері түрлі мәдениеттердің сындарлы соғбарты орталығына айналды. Дүние жүзіндегі беделді дін басылар бір шаңырақ.
Now the President of the Republic of Kazakhstan, Kasym-Jomart Tokayev, for the summing up of the results of the Congress.
Келіп отырсыздар. Осының өзі дінаралық келісім мен ынтымақтастықтың қаншалықты маңызды екенін көрсетеді. Шын мәнінде бәріміздің мақсатымыз бір. Бұл өркениеттер үндестігін орнату және бейбітшілік пен тұрақтылықты нығайту. Съезге көптеген салмақты ой, салиқалы пікір айтылды. Оның бәрі біздің үлесімді әлем құру жолындағы іс-әрекетімізге оң ықпалын тигізеді деп санаймын. Мен алқалы жиынға арнайы келген әлемдік деңгейдегі рухани көшбасшыларға зор алғыс айтамын. Сондай-ақ біздің бастамамызға қолдау көрсеткен саясаткерлер мен халықаралық ұйым өкілдеріне шынайы ризашылымды білдіремін. Форумды өткізуге белсене атсалысқан дипломаттарға, волонтерлерге, журналисттер мен басқа да азаматтарға рахметімді айтқым келеді. Dear Congress participants, our forum has taken place at a unique and highly consequential global moment. It's historic in its own way. As we face an increasingly turbulent geopolitical post-pandemic world, it becomes more crucial to develop new approaches to strengthening inter-civilizational dialogue and trust at the global level. I believe today's forum has made a significant contribution to this vital ongoing work. On behalf of the people of Kazakhstan, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to His Holiness Pope Francis for his historic visit to our country and participation in the work of the Congress. We are confident that your passionate voice and strong message will be a source of inspiration and hope for many millions around the world. Осы орайда, аса қадірлі Рим папасы Франциске елімізге тарихи сапармен келгені үшін Қазақстан халқының және жеке өз атымнан тағы да шынайы алғыс білдіремін. Съезд жұмысына өзіңіздің белсене қатысуыңыз біз үшін зор мәртебе. Сіздің әлем жұртшылығына арнаған үндеуіңіз жер жүзіндегі миллиондаған адамға үміт пен сенім сыйлағаны анық. The participants of the Congress have shared their perspectives, offered valuable ideas, and generated insightful proposals on many pressing issues. Most importantly, they have focused their thoughts on peace and cooperation between faith and peoples. We have collectively condemned both power politics and hate speech, which contribute to the mutual alienation of nations, the erosion of states, and the degradation of international relations. Today, as never before, it's vital to put to good use the peacemaking potential of religions, to unite the efforts of spiritual authorities in search of long-term stability. All faiths are based on humanistic ideals, recognition of the supreme value of human life, and the aspiration for peace and creation. These fundamental principles must be reflected not only in the spiritual area, but also in the socio-economic development of states and international politics. One of the most important topics was how to overcome inequalities of all kinds, since they are a source of national upheavals and global crises. Special emphasis was placed on digital and gender issues, on the importance of education, and on the role of religion in eliminating social divides. Another fundamental objective was the search for ways to strike a balance between economic growth and spiritual and moral progress. I am convinced that religious leaders can and must insist on simultaneous and complementary spiritual and technological development. Dear participants, as we conclude our work together here, I am convinced that spiritual leaders can and will help in overcoming the contradictions of the modern world and in achieving greater well-being for all humanity. A meaningful and highly detailed declaration has been adopted at the conclusion of this Congress, This important document covers fundamental issues and can serve as a guide for governments, political leaders, and international organizations. Our joint task is to consistently promote the concepts and principles of the Declaration. I also believe it is necessary to prepare a concept document for the development of the Congress of Leaders of World and Traditional Religions for the years 2023-2033. This concept document should include concrete steps and stages in further strengthening the influence of our forum, in line with its domestic and foreign policy priorities. Kazakhstan will fully support the consistent activities of the Congress. Our aim remains to promote an open dialogue among civilizations and to strengthen peace and stability. Once again, my sincere gratitude to all of you, and let's work together for the sake of peace, tolerance, and cooperation. I wish everyone well-being and peaceful life.
Құрметті Қасым-Жомарт Кемелұлы, съезге қатысып, мазмұнды баяндама жасап, бейбітшілік, келісім және диалог идеяларын дәріптеуге үлкен үлес қосқаныңыз үшін барша
The closing of the ceremony now by Maulin Ashimbayev, the head of the Secretariat of the Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions and chairman of the Senate of the Parliament of the Republic of Kazakhstan.
Главам делегации и всем участникам съезда за поддержку нашего форума и большой вклад в укрепление диалога между религиями, культурами и народами. От имени секретариата съезда хотел бы еще раз отметить твердое намерение и готовность активно продвигать идеи и принципы изложенные декларации. Этот документ будет распространен в качестве официального документа 77-й сессии Генеральной Ассамблеи ООН. Секретариат также приступит к разработке концепции развития съезда лидеров мировых и традиционных религий как универсальной глобальной межрелигиозной диалоговой площадки на 2023-2033 годы. В этот документ войдут ваши идеи и предложения, итоги дискуссий, состоявшихся на съезде. Құрметті Қасым-Жомарт Кемелұлы, аса қасиетті Рим Папасы Франциск, жоғары мәртебелілер. Сіздердің ынта-жігерлеріңіздің арқасында әлемде диалогқа, ашықтыққа, өзара түсіністік пен бейбіт өмірге деген ұмтылыс нығая түседі деп сенеміз. Форумның барлық қатысушылары мен қонақтарына тағы да зор алғысымызды білдіреміз. Осымен әлемдік және дәстүрлі діндер лидерлерінің 7-ші съезінің жұмысын жабық деп жариялауға рұқсат етіңіздер. Баршаңызға рахмет. Қазақ елінде қайта кездескенше аман болыңыздар.
And with that, the ceremony of the 7th Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions comes to an end at the Independence Palace in Nur-Sultan, Kazakhstan, Kazakhstan's capital. From here, the Pope will go straight to the airport where there will be a departure ceremony with the presence of the President. The Pope is scheduled to depart from Nur-Sultan Airport at 1 p.m. local time. It is now, 1 p.m. Rome time, and to arrive back in Rome's Fiumicino Airport at around 8:30 p.m. local time. And this is what brings us to an end to this Pope's meeting with authorities, civil society, and, excuse me, the end of the final closing ceremony of the 7th Congress of the Leaders of World and Traditional Religions. On behalf of Vatican Radio, I'd like to thank our partners who help make these live broadcasts available throughout the world, including Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World Television Networks USA, EWTN TV, Salt and Light TV, Luminous Radio India, Catholic TV, Shalom TV India, and Sunday Shalom. I'd also like to thank all of our producers and technicians here in studio who made this broadcast possible. And thanks to all of you for joining us today. I'm Francesca Merlo, and it has been a pleasure providing coverage of the Holy Father's final meeting in Kazakhstan today. Laudetur Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ.